Okay, we are at 5 minutes after, so we're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome and good evening, everybody, to the Collaborative Technical Assistance Homeowners Association Information Series. This is session one, Living with Dams, Know Your Risk. I've been noted a couple times now, but I just want to make sure that everybody is connected in every way that they need to be. Please make sure you are on the audio, which is the number on the screen and in the chat box, as well as logged into the Adobe Connect. If at any point during this webinar you have any technical issues, please email me at alicia@yources.com. I will also put it in the chat so that when this slide goes away, you'll still have access to it. A couple of housekeeping items. We will be doing roll call in just a moment as we need that for everyone's accreditation. Again, as I noted, that's the old phone number. Please don't use that one. I thought I updated in both places. If you have any technical difficulties, please email me. This webinar is being recorded so that we can make an online version following the webinar in a couple of weeks. The phone lines will remain muted until the end of the presentation. We ask that throughout the duration of the presentations, if you have any questions, please log them into the chat box as we will be using that to call on people and address your questions during the Q&A session. If for some reason we run out of time and your questions are not answered during the Q&A session, we will contact everyone directly after the webinar to further address your questions. With that, I will pass it to Mr. John McCain. John?
Yes. Hey, good evening, everyone. My name is John McCain. I'm the manager of the Dam Safety Program at South Carolina DHEC. And we are really excited, you know, to be putting on this this webinar series for our homeowners associations and property owners associations that are also dam owners. So today we have our first of the four webinars that we have planned. Our agenda for tonight, after our welcome and some opening remarks from the other presenters, we'll talk about the goals and objectives for not just tonight but for the webinar series. We'll talk about what makes homeowners associations and property owners associations unique among dam owners. We'll try to help you understand and know what your responsibility and your liability both are as dam owners. I'll talk a bit about some of the basics of dam safety. We could make an entire series of webinars on that topic, so we won't spend too much time there. I'll point you to some additional resources on that topic at the end of our presentation. We'll have a discussion of risk and knowing your risk. Then we will introduce you to your emergency action plan and the emergency action planning process and actually how do you respond in the event of an emergency. Then we will describe some resources and provide a list of some resources available. And lastly, you know, we'll close and then we'll talk about the next steps and what the additional the webinars we have in store for you all for the next 3 months. So we'll close with that. So moving on, we will move to our welcome and opening remarks. And again, I'd like to welcome you on behalf of South Carolina DHEC and the Dam Safety Program. We are pleased, you know, to have such, in my opinion, excellent turnout and excellent, a great deal of interest from HOA and POA members. And so, again, I'm glad to have you all here, and I hope we can really you know, meet your needs and meet your expectations. And if not, you definitely please let us know. But that's enough from me. And so I'll let the other presenters introduce themselves. I believe we have the National Dam Safety Program at FEMA. Preston, do you want to?
Yeah, good evening. My name is Preston Wilson. I'm with FEMA's National Dam Safety Program. And I'm so excited to be working with South Carolina DHEC to help to deliver this program. And you're so lucky to have a state that really cares as much as South Carolina did. They put a lot lot into this. And so I'm really happy and really excited to be working with them today. Also, I would like to have my contractor, who's been talking a little bit, to introduce herself really fast too.
Thanks, Preston. Hi, everybody. My name is Alicia Zagara, and we are the communication outreach contact for FEMA's National Dam Safety Program. Throughout the sessions over the next couple of months, you'll be seeing lots of emails from me. So if you ever need anything additional, please feel free to reach out. Thank you.
And moving on, let's see. Nick, do you want to introduce yourself? Nick, are you on the line? Hey, Molly, do you want to go?
Hi, thank you, John. I appreciate the introduction. My name is Molly Fencer. I am an environmental systems scientist at Argonne National Laboratory. I work with the National Dam Safety Office and the National Integration Center at FEMA to help deliver the technical assistance programs, especially surrounding dam safety.
Okay, and do we still not have Nick?
I will try to contact Nick offline to see if where he is.
Okay, thank you, Molly. I guess we'll move on, and we'll let Nick introduce himself when his turn to present comes. All right, so I will, just to talk a bit about, so the technical information series that we are providing the goal, you know, obviously is we want to increase knowledge and understanding, and especially among HOA dam owners, and related to basic dam safety terminology, concepts, technical concepts, and emergency management practices. And so some of the objectives we have is for our HOA members to gain a better understanding of the concepts and terminology, and also the relationships that arise or are activated during a dam emergency that inform both planning activities, the response, and recovery activities. From an emergency. We also are another objective is to develop a relationship or at least to help our HOAs develop relationships with local emergency management offices and to better understand the roles and responsibilities of dam owners and emergency managers. A third objective, We hope that our HOAs will learn about operational and maintenance requirements for dams to keep them functioning properly and safely, including how to perform a self-inspection of a dam and how to prepare for incoming floods. And our fourth, to gain an awareness of the unique challenges that come with HOA ownership of dams. And that's a special topic of this webinar series. The unique challenges. So to provide the understanding and tools to hopefully avoid, but also be prepared for, unplanned events or dam-related incidents. And those are our four objectives for this series of webinars. And the schedule, again, after today's webinar, we have three more webinars planned. These are the first Tuesday of every month. May, June, and July are still on the horizon. And the topics with our May webinar will really dig into understanding emergency action plans and inundation maps and some of the how DHEC creates inundation maps and how that that some of the technical aspects of that, and then how DHEC and yourselves, the dam owners, can work together to create an emergency action plan and to help you be comfortable and familiar with your emergency action plan. In June, FEMA will lead the June webinar and really focus on risk and crisis communication strategies for those dam emergencies or emergency situations with dams. Something FEMA has, very special expertise and subject matter experts that can really shed light and bring a lot to the table for that webinar. And then our July webinar, we'll conclude with some unique considerations for HOA dam owners. And we're planning on, we want to focus on, some of the legal and financial and those types of challenges and solutions that HOA dam owners face. And we'll talk a bit about that more, but we're still in the process of lining up some good speakers, good presenters that have really the subject matter expertise that can really we believe will bring a lot of good knowledge and experience to this group. So we're excited about these webinars, and we're really meeting a need. We hope so, and we want the feedback from you all. If we're not meeting your needs and your expectations, please let us know. So moving on. Today's session, Living with Dams, Know Your Risks, our outcomes, we want to, help you discover some of the responsibilities and liabilities your HOA or POA face as a dam owner. So learn some of the basics of dam safety, be introduced to risk-related concepts for dam emergencies and the need for emergency action plans. From here on out, EAPs. Is the acronym. We'll learn about some resources available to support HOA and POA dam owners and operators, and then learn about the importance of relationships with state and local officials and with other dam owners. So I'm going to get started, and the whole point of this series of webinars is because HOAs and POAs are a unique situation and challenge among dam owners. And why is this? Just from these pictures, you can see, the HOAs these community or neighborhood dams and ponds are, shared by groups of people. They have common areas, they're used for recreation and walking and relaxation, but that also brings with it challenges and problems. So again, some of the benefits of living in a community or neighborhood and being part of an HOA or POA is that you have common areas, and that allows you to enjoy, the water. You have walking trails, again, fishing, wildlife, et cetera. And also water, living near the water increases property values. Another benefit is that there's when you have a joint ownership situation, you share that legal responsibility so that no one is faced with that challenge alone. It's something that can be shared. Again, and furthermore, the costs, you know, as many of you may know, the cost of dam operation and maintenance can be extensive and intimidating. And so in an HOA, you have the benefit of being able to share that cost. Basically, it's a larger pool of resources is what I'm getting at. And so that's a benefit. That definitely is a pro. And then again, the duties associated with dam ownership can be divided, whether that's inspection, maintenance, being prepared and responding in an emergency, et cetera. All these duties can be subdivided and shared among your membership, which can, you know, ease the burden on any one person. But then again, this brings with it some negatives, some cons of HOA ownership. For instance, these common areas can also be a means for anyone to access the dam, including the spillways and control structures, especially if you don't have, those parts of your dam secured or fenced off. Unlike a private landowner who can, restrict access, it's much more difficult when you have a community or a neighborhood. Another con that we've identified and that many of you probably are aware of is that you're frequently seeing people come and go, move into your neighborhoods and leave your neighborhoods, or your boards or your officers are changing due to elections, people serve on a voluntary basis for the most part. So you basically have a revolving door of members and people that make it difficult to maintain a technical expertise or a real deep knowledge and understanding of your dam and how it functions and how it should be operated and maintained. Another negative that we've identified and have seen, firsthand experience is that oftentimes the covenants or bylaws that govern HOAs are ineffective, and this may be a result of purely the age of your neighborhood may predate dam safety regulation in South Carolina. The law that the Dam Safety Act in South Carolina was not passed by the legislature until the late 70s, 1978, I believe. And so many of your neighborhoods may predate that and so did not envision the liability and responsibilities nor the expenses that can arise when you have a regulated dam. Potential problem is that in an HOA, your decision-making process is slowed by the fact that you have these covenants and bylaws, and most decisions, most major decisions do require a vote, and with any vote, it's possible that you struggle to reach a consensus and getting everyone to agree what is the right course of action. Your covenants and bylaws also can be limiting on how you raise funds or take on debt for needed maintenance and repair. And then lastly, unpopular decisions such as spending money can be deferred, kick the can down the road mentality. And those needed maintenance and repair items, when they're deferred, can only mean that when you do ultimately address the problem, it's likely going to be much more expensive. So we will now talk about some of your responsibility and liabilities as an HOA owner of a dam. But first, do need to point out, we are not attorneys. Nothing contained herein or spoken by myself or any employee of DHEC is to be taken as legal advice for your specific situation. Every dam ownership situation is unique for a myriad of reasons, and advice for your special, specific circumstances should be obtained from a qualified legal professional. And so the discussion that follows is really addressing responsibility and liability in very broad, general terms. This is not, everybody's situation is different. And so we can't hope to give you advice for your specific situation. This is just, hopefully we can maybe open, shed some light on some of these issues, and what you learned today, combined with what you can get from a legal professional, will be ultimately, what you can use to direct your dam and your HOA situation. So I briefly mentioned the Dams and Reservoir Safety Act a second ago, which was passed by the legislature in the late 70s. And you can find this act in the South Carolina Code of Laws, Title 49, Chapter 11, Article 3. And the citation is the South Carolina Code of Laws, Section 49.11, and then 120 is where you'll find the definition of an owner of a dam is those who own, control, operate, maintain, manage, or propose to construct a dam. And as you can see, that's a very broad definition. But that is the law, the law of the land, and what who is defined as a dam owner. Then if we look at Section 49.11.150, we find that the owner is solely responsible for the safe condition of the dam throughout the structure's life. We also, in that section, the dam owner is responsible for notifying DHEC of change of ownership of the dam. And lastly, that's also where you will find the emergency action plan requirement that all dam owners, all dams that are high or significant hazard must have an EAP. And then Section 49.11.250 states that neither the action nor failure to act relieves the owner or operator of his or her duties, obligations, responsibilities, or liabilities arising from ownership of a dam. So those are just some important piece, important sections of the Act. It's not a long, it's a very short document, the Article 3, the Dams and Reservoir Safety Act. So I definitely advise everyone to read it. It's very short, and and I think these are just some of the highlights I wanted to share that speak to responsibility. And then in addition to the Act in South Carolina, we have the Code of Regulations, Regulation 72-1 through 72-9. Those constitute the Dams and Reservoir Safety Act regulations. And these regulations spell out in more detail all of the requirements that are placed on dam owners in South Carolina. So I'd like to introduce everyone to a concept called standard of duty or standard of care. And this is kind of the concept that there is a standard that everyone who owns a dam is expected to maintain in the operations and maintenance of your dam. And so you won't find this really in our regulations. This is more, again, general knowledge, kind of understanding. But dam owners are generally considered responsible for carrying out the following duties: inspecting their dam regularly and completely. And by inspect, this is not necessarily the same as a DHEC inspection, but this is basically to state that the dam owner is responsible for knowing the condition of their dam. So monitoring those conditions regularly. Also, dam owners are considered responsible for maintaining their dam structure and related equipment, meeting the regulations, being in compliance with the DHEC regulations, preparing and following an operations manual. And an operations manual is more important for HOAs than other dams, and it, for that same reason that people come and go. There's a revolving door of members in an HOA, and so that operations manual can provide some continuity as people come and go. Having a written operations manual can be very important and very, very helpful for your specific situation. Also, dam owners are responsible for preparing, then testing and updating their EAP. And then lastly, maintaining a complete set of records on your dam, maintaining those inspection reports, maintaining your engineer documents, your maintenance records, when maintenance was performed. So just like keeping your car maintained and keeping records on how you maintain your car, it's the same for your dam. And then these minimum standards of duty or care are set forth in the Act, in the regulations, in local ordinances, which is something that is definitely different for probably everyone here. Your county ordinances or municipal ordinances may dictate something, maybe a higher level of care or standard of duty than the regulations. And then lastly, professional and industry standards. If you're a regulated dam and you want to do any work on your dam, you have to have an engineer design, put together a permit application and direct the work, direct your contractor. And so professional engineers and contractors are held to these standards, these national professional standards or industry standards. So those apply to you as well. If they apply to your engineer, then they apply to you. And so if you know your responsibility and you know your standard of care, the failure to uphold that is known as that's negligence. And so the standard of care for a dam is the legal obligation requiring operation and maintenance, basically to prevent harm to others, is what your mission and your duty is. The standard of care is essentially to prevent harm to others. Is what we're all basically. That's what dam safety is all about. And so liability. We've talked a bit about responsibility. So when are you liable? When does liability become an issue? What acts or failure to act results in liability? Well, first off, failure to warn or guard the public against injury from a dangerous condition that was known or should have been known is one form of liability. Another one is would be to fail to properly construct or maintain in good repair your dam. Another potential source of liability is if the owner or operator does not identify an unreasonably dangerous condition and fails to correct that condition or to warn potential victims of the existence of that condition within a reasonable period. Another source of liability is if the owner or operator does not have to insure against the possibility of injury, but must act reasonably to prevent that injury. Again, insurance is not required, but the requirement to act is expected. And lastly, owners and operators are obligated to inspect their dams and adjoining areas to identify potential hazards to the public and to take actions to minimize the risks of injury. So just to summarize liability, so compliance with government or professional standards does not absolve an owner from liability. So just by meeting those regs or those professional standards does not absolve anyone from liability. But it does show that you are maintaining a minimum standard of care. And then another summary statement. So in general, a dam owner is required to use reasonable care in the operation and maintenance of the dam or reservoir. So, again, we are talking a lot about some things that we can't really get into anyone's specific situation. And that's unfortunate, but maybe some of these concepts, maybe these are resonating with folks. And so now you want to talk to some, qualified legal professionals. And that would be definitely advisable. Someone who can take your specific circumstances and look and apply the dam safety legal and regulatory framework here in South Carolina and apply that to your specific set of circumstances. I would strongly recommend, if you have any concern about knowing your responsibility or liability, money well spent and time well spent. So, again, DHEC, we cannot provide legal advice, but we can definitely advise on what the regulations require. And so we want to help you as much as we can, but you really have to talk to a legal professional to truly understand your situation. So I guess I do have one more slide on liability. Liability exists.
Hey, John.
Hey.
Apologies. I'm not sure your slides are progressing.
Do you not see slide 23
right now?
We're
still seeing know your responsibility.
Uh-oh. Are you not seeing them? Are you not seeing the slides move right now?
They just started moving.
18. So I'm on 18 now. Do you see 18?
Yes.
19.
Correct. Now they're moving.
I don't know what happened. I'm sorry, everyone, if that. So I've talked a lot about liability from slides 21. 21 is the liability. 22. And now this is the current slide I was about to discuss. So can you see this slide 23 with the photo of the inundation area?
Yes, we can.
Okay. I apologize, everyone. So liability exists if an injury or damage occurred, or if maybe just dangerous conditions existed and had the potential for harm. Obviously, if negligent or wrongful actions created the condition, liability exists. And then, if an owner or operator knew of a problem or did not knew of a problem and did not act, I think we have a typo there. If an owner or operator knew of a problem and did not correct that problem. What you're looking at is an example of an inundation map that DHEC has prepared. And so we can help. DHEC can definitely provide that service. We can do this, create this map that would show that would show these areas where the flood waters would go. If a dam were to fail, we have software and modeling software that we can use to predict where the water would go. So we can help you with that. That's a service DHEC can provide. And so in summary, like with everything in our society, you can always be sued. And so, failure, the liability, exists for many, many reasons, you can always be sued. That's the summary statement. Maybe you're asking some questions. Here we kind of envision some questions you might be asking. Hey, DHEC, how is liability shared in an HOA? Does everyone in the HOA share this liability equally? That's a tough question to answer. So, DHEC's answer here is that there is no one answer, because every HOA or POA is set up differently and has different covenants and bylaws. How your HOA is or maybe is not incorporated plays a role. You have to, again, look at your unique situation and talk to a legal professional. Here's another question that we thought people might ask. Hey, DHEC, if I serve as my HOA's main point of contact for the dam, am I taking on personal liability? What happens if something goes wrong on my watch? So maybe someone within your HOA has taken on the dam as their personal or their kind of their duty. Their role is to be the your dam officer in a sense. So what personal liability this may bring with it, again, it's hard to say with any specificity for your particular HOA, because it depends on the duties of that role. Is this person actually operating the dam, opening valves or pulling boards to release water, or is this person responsible for enacting the emergency action plan in the event of an emergency? So the duties of the role, how your HOA is structured is again something you'd have to look at, and it would be something to take up with the officers of the HOA and consult a legal professional. There definitely is some possibility for individual liability. The possibility exists. We would definitely advise you to both take, you know, your officers and legal professional should be consulted. And so now I'm going to quickly go through some of the basics of dam safety. Again, I don't want to cover this too much because we have other resources on our website that that you can look at, and we'll share that. We'll share those resources. But Alicia, has everyone seen the basics of dam safety slide?
Yes, we are.
All right. So the basics. Here's your first big rule. Basic of dam safety number one. What makes a dam subject to regulation? So, you know, most of you probably know this, but any dam that is 25 feet in height or greater, any dam that has the ability to impound 50 acre feet of water or greater, and an acre foot, you know, is of just a unit of volume. If you have 1 acre, 1 foot deep, that is 1 acre foot of water. If you have 50 acres, 1 foot deep, that's 50 acre feet. And so it's a unit of volume. And so any dam that impounds 50 acre feet or more would be subject to regulation. And then lastly, any dam, regardless of its height or impoundment volume, that could cause loss of life is also subject to regulation. And then in South Carolina, the Dams and Reservoir Safety Act has three hazard potential classifications that dams fall into. You're one of these three if you are a regulated dam. And so high hazard, you know, in short, think of high hazard as potential for loss of life. Significant hazard, you know, think of significant hazard as not likely to cause loss of life, but may damage homes, industrial, commercial facilities, and infrastructure. And then lastly, low hazard dams are dams that really are not expected to have really any consequences. A minimal property damage is about all we would expect from the failure of a low hazard dam. And so, it is DHEC's job to assign a hazard potential classification. Ultimately, it's DHEC's decision, and DHEC has the authority. But we also we don't do this in a vacuum. Some of the factors that go into the hazard potential classification are as follows. The first is input from the dam owner and or the dam owner's engineer. And what I mean by input, knowing what is downstream of the dam is generally something the dam owner is going to know better than DHEC. We may say there's a house or a structure downstream that would be flooded in the event of the dam failing, and so the dam owner can tell us, no, that is not a house. That's a vacant, dilapidated barn so that kind of information can really inform DHEC's hazard class assessment. And also the dam owner's engineer can provide, technical information to help us in how we set up our model and how we run the simulation to determine what areas will flood. And, and the dam owner's engineer can do modeling too. Maybe the dam owner's engineer wants to, doesn't agree with the simulation that we ran. And so we would definitely take the dam owner's engineer simulation or, inputs technical insight and definitely take that into consideration. And then the other big things are obviously the improved property downstream of the dam, which homes, roads, utilities, et cetera, exist in the downstream area. And then we use our modeling software to simulate the dam failure. And we have to use engineering judgment, but all these factors, all these pieces fit together, and as a result, DHEC assigns a hazard class. And so when we make that decision, we generally, you know, give we make a preliminary determination first, and then tell the dam owner, this is what we believe the hazard class should be. And then we generally allow a 60-day review period and dispute period before we make a final decision. And so one thing to point out, we want to make this very clear, is that the hazard potential classification is entirely determined by what's downstream that would be impacted by failure of the dam. It has nothing to do with the condition of the dam itself. The dam could be, you know, the best, most impressive dam you've ever seen, you know, but it could still be high hazard purely due to the fact that what is downstream. So again, just to reiterate, the condition of the dam itself is irrelevant to this determination. And so briefly, let's kind of cover some of the parts of a dam, just so that we're all using the same terminology. So your pond or your lake or your pond is also called a reservoir or impoundment. You have a principal spillway, generally. Sometimes it's called a riser pipe or a drop inlet or an overflow weir. But in general, we refer to it as a principal spillway, which is, you know, which is where the daily flow, the daily outflow from your pond goes through your principal spillway. That's the daily release of water. Then you have an auxiliary spillway, or also called an emergency spillway, that is for the release of water in more extreme situations. Not day to day. You know, your emergency spillway or auxiliary spillway should really not be flowing on a day to day basis. Those are for your more extreme events. Your primary spillway has an outlet pipe that generally, you know, penetrates the dam and comes out, you know, at the bottom on the downstream side of the dam. These are sometimes called a barrel or a spillway conduit. Where the dam makes contact with the natural earth is called the abutment. And so dams generally have a right abutment and a left abutment. And so if you're looking downstream, your right-hand side would be the right abutment, and your left-hand side would be the left abutment. The convention is always looking downstream, and that is how left and right is determined for dams. The crest of the dam is the top, the highest point. Generally, dam crests should be level. We don't always see that. Sometimes crests have higher, you know, high spots and low spots. But ideally, your dam crest is level. Where your dam comes in contact with the abutment are called the abutment contacts or groins. The downstream slope, obviously, is the downstream face. There's obviously an upstream slope and an upstream face. but this image doesn't show that. You have an outlet works where the flow from your primary spillway emerges on the downstream side of the dam. The toe is generally where the downstream slope meets the natural ground at the bottom of the dam. And so those are some of the basic terms with the parts of a dam. And so looking at an actual dam, you can see where these what these look like on an actual dam. And then looking at a dam in cross section, knowing some of how the spillway operates. Again, the primary spillway is the day-to-day method of controlling the water level in your impoundment. It's your day-to-day release of water. Your spillway should have a trash rack. Some method to prevent, debris from falling into your spillway and potentially obstructing flow, getting stuck or lodged in your spillway or in your outlet pipe. Many dams, not all, but many dams have a low-level drain or low-level gate valve that allows for water. For draining the lake if needed, and also lowering your lake to a level below the top of your primary spillway. The valve is generally operated from above the waterline, and so you have a connection between the gate and the operator, called the valve stem. And so the gate valve wheel, by turning the wheel, you can raise and lower your gate. And then again, the spillway outlet pipe passes through the dam, also called a barrel or an outlet conduit. And where the water emerges is your outlet works. You generally need some method to relieve and disperse the energy of that water as it emerges from your outlet pipe. And so that's the purpose of a stilling basin or a plunge pool. It's a means of energy dissipation so that you don't have erosion of that area right at the toe of the dam. And then more recently, in more recent designs and construction of dams, we see soil filters and drains that are used to relieve, almost like a French drain, to relieve and help reduce the buildup of water inside the dam, in the embankment. So the filter and drain provide a release for that, for that water, like almost like groundwater that builds up inside of the dam, and so we see that more and more often in dams built to modern standards and modern design. And then briefly, we'll talk about some of the problems that we see with dams. What you can expect to see. Most of you have probably seen at least a few of these. Internal erosion is the process where the earthen material within the dam is removed, either by, in some cases, at pipe joints is a very common occurrence, where joints of the pipe separate over time and provide a means for the soil of the dam itself to be removed from the dam. And this is not always at pipes. This can be maybe it's along a tree root. Maybe you have trees on your dam, and so the roots are providing a pathway for internal erosion, or maybe cracks. You know, as you can see, cracking and foundation settlement can provide pathways for this, for erosion and the removal of soil within the dam. A low area in the crest of your dam, as I mentioned before, ideally your crest is level along the length of the dam, but that's not always the case. And a low area in the crest can be a location where flow will concentrate. If say you reach an overtopping water level, you can have channelized and concentrated flow, and that can progressively, eat away at your dam and cut into the dam itself, and that can definitely lead to failure of your dam. Animals, nuisance animal activity is a very common problem, and I'm sure all of you have probably had beavers or some other type of rodent trouble with your dam. Trees and brush, probably every dam. I would place a bet every dam has dealt with that particular problem. Seepage and piping. In this particular picture, it's occurring at the groin, and so seepage and piping are basically part of that internal erosion mechanism, and seepage can progress as it gets worse and as time goes on into a situation called piping, where it's almost as if there's a pipe through your dam. Where it's really just a pathway and that's been created through erosion, but it can advance to the point where it's almost like having a pipe through your dam, and that's why it's called piping. A boil is similar to seepage, but a boil is usually observed beyond the toe of the dam. Not actually on the embankment, but downstream and beyond the toe of the dam. Slumps or slides on the downstream slope are also common. That's something definitely to look for, and it can be again part of seepage can be a factor. Overly steep slopes can definitely be a factor, that's another very common problem. Concrete structures, anything made of concrete on your dam, is probably going to crack at some point. Again, if you don't have any ability to any capability for energy dissipation. Where that primary spillway, where your outlet works is located, you're going to get erosion. And so either a stilling basin or a plunge pool or something at that location can help control erosion. If erosion at the outlet is allowed to continue, that can ultimately undermine your outlet works or undermine your pipe. And cause either the pipe or the structure there to collapse, with very very bad consequences. And then there's all other things that can happen deep within your dam, stability issues that also can be problematic. Trees and vegetation, you know, is probably the number one problem that we see. And why is that bad? Well, vegetation obscures inspections, can harbor rodents, and can turn and topple in high winds. And when a tree topples in high winds, that root system that gets uprooted can definitely provide a channel in the dam, either if it's on the crest of the dam, can provide a means of overtopping of the dam, or can almost be like pulling a plug on a bathtub. And well, I'll show a picture of that here shortly. But trees and tree roots definitely do not belong on or in a dam. Tree roots can provide a pathway for seepage and piping through the dam. Excessive vegetation can result in debris in the spillway, which can obstruct flow and which can lead to failure of the dam. In that instance, we're talking more about your auxiliary spillway or your emergency spillway. You know, if you have trees growing in your auxiliary spillway, that can severely restrict the flow that should be allowed, you know, should be able to pass through. So it's important to monitor for trees and woody vegetation and remove it before it can become a problem. And here in South Carolina, our rule of thumb is that trees less than 4 inches in diameter, that we allow those to just be removed as maintenance. You can just cut them flush with the ground, treat the roots with an herbicide to make sure that they don't come back, but just cut them and be done with it before they can grow, you know, to a large enough size to really do some damage. And once they get above 4 inches in diameter, that's where we really have to look and determine if the root systems also need to be removed, because they may, you know, maybe they have grown to an extent where they could potentially cause a seepage or piping issue through the dam. And when root system removal is necessary, we require a permit. And here's a picture of a dam where we actually, the owner removed the trees. This was not due to high winds, but as a result of the root ball being removed, it was like a pipe was present. A pipe had been opened and a plug had been removed from the end of that pipe, allowing water to flow out. So it can happen where the tree, you know, the tree roots are basically going to penetrate the dam and contribute to an uncontrolled release if the tree were to be overturned and the roots uprooted. So knowing the condition of your dam is critical. You need to keep a file, keep your records. You need to know what your inspection rating was on your last inspection. How often should you be inspecting your dam? Well, you always need to know the condition of it. So that's up to you. But DHEC only inspects every 2 years for high hazard, or every 3 years for significant hazard. So DHEC is not the best resource as far as the condition of your dam. You are the best resource. So DHEC is only 6 engineers in the state of South Carolina performing dam safety inspections. So we need the dam owners to be to help us, and you need to be, again, as your responsibility, know the condition of your dam. And so, I briefly talked about a bit about maintenance and repair. I think I'm, you know, with respect to tree removal at least, but in broader terms, maintenance items, you know, should be done whenever they're needed, whenever you see a need for maintenance. And one way we kind of distinguish what is maintenance and repair, just think about maintenance as something that, you know, even if done poorly, it's really impossible to damage the dam, to really cause harm to the dam by doing maintenance. And it really doesn't require any special technical expertise. And so because of that, it doesn't require a permit from DHEC to do maintenance. And some examples would be mowing, cutting brush, removing debris from spillways, maybe repairing areas where you have some real shallow erosion. So you're going to fill those areas in and try to get grass to get established, seeding areas that don't have grass, or maybe, you know, sanding down rusted pieces on your spillway, you know, and painting those metal surfaces to protect them. And then repair items are the opposite. You know, if not done correctly, it is possible to cause serious damage or performance issues with the dam, to the point that it could lead to dam failure. And so repair items require the involvement of a licensed professional engineer. And they also require a permit from DHEC before starting work. And some examples of these are sizing of pipe for spillways, repairing a breached or maybe a partially breached part of your dam, stabilizing slopes. Maybe you have a slump or a slide, like we talked about, and figuring out how to stabilize and repair that area is something that you need the special expertise of an engineer. Or installing some kind of internal filter and drain system to control seepage. All those are items that, you know, are not, you know, require special expertise. And honestly, not even all engineers are qualified. It takes an engineer who has specific expertise with dams. And so, you know, that's just a word of warning is, you know, working with an engineer, you need to make sure that engineer has the unique qualifications to do work on dams. And then just some pictures of needed maintenance, you know, spillways being blocked, debris, you know, lack of maintenance is something that, you know, there's no excuse, and it's something that can be, you know, so easily, you know, corrected before it becomes a repair problem. And so when a repair is needed, you know, and a permit from DHEC is required, just real briefly to understand how that works. And so, you know, first off, you have to apply to DHEC for that permit. And so a permit application has to be prepared by that licensed engineer, and then submitted to DHEC, where the dam safety staff will review that permit. We may have comments to send back to the engineer. It's possible we don't have comments, and that we go directly to issuance of a permit. But if we do have comments, then the engineer has to address those comments. And so we would then review whatever the engineer, whatever revisions or response to comments that the engineer provides. And then ultimately, upon issuance of a permit, then you can start your work. So that's the permit process in brief for repairs on dams. I appreciate everyone bearing with me. I know that was a lot to go through, but I'm going to turn it over now to Preston Wilson to talk about risk.
Well, thank you, John, and I plan on building on a lot of what you just talked about, but it really excites me today to really have you really be able to talk about knowing your risk and helping you to really understand your risk, because really, if you think about it, all dams have risk, and I'm gonna repeat what I just said, that all dams have risk. And to prove that, just let's look at the definition of a dam. A dam, it means, and this, there's many definitions of a dam, but this is one I picked out for this. It means any artificial barrier that has the ability to impound water, wastewater, or any liquid-borne material for the purposes of storage or control of water. So any dam that has the capability of storing or holding back water has risk. And now I'm going to kind of jump into what really are those risks. And to really understand what your dam risks are, you have to understand what is dam risk. And dam risk, and we look at dam risk, within three components. That's your threats, your performance, and your consequences. Your threats are what's loading the dam. What are the threats that are likely to occur at your dam? And we're going to get into what those threats are in a second. John talked a lot about the performance factor. And that's how will your dam perform when it's loaded by these threats or just regular loading. It's just the performance of the dam. And we have a good understanding now of some of the performance issues of the dams. But I'll talk a little bit about how that fits in. And then thirdly, last but definitely not least, what are the consequences? If the dam was potentially going to fail, who or what would be in harm's way of the dam? And that's a myriad of things. Those are things like people are going to be in the way, homes are going to be in the way, business is going to be in the way, recreational facilities are going to be. A lot of things are going to be impacted if your dam was to fail. So those are consequences. And those three things together, all right, make up risk, and not one by themselves. Those three things together make up risk, and we're going to talk a little bit about them now. And this is really set up, let's talk a little bit about the threats, but this is really set up to, just looking at South Carolina and your threats. These may be different from different dams, and I'll show you an example in a second. It could be different even in the same state of South Carolina, but let's look at some of these threats. Are some of these loading conditions. You got floods or extreme rainfall. You got high winds, earthquakes, human error, sabotage. Now let's look at flood. In flood, your threat in South Carolina might be there might be a high likelihood. You guys get extreme rainfall. You're able to predict it. You had some extreme rainfalls due to some hurricane rain loads that came through. These are things that historical data, you are able to say, hey, the likelihood of my dam experiencing this is very high. Let's move on to another threat. Maybe high winds, maybe the same thing. You got hurricane force winds that come through and hit off in certain part of your state. Some part of your states may get tornadoes, so that might be a medium likelihood of occurrence. Earthquake, maybe in your state, might be a low likelihood of occurrence. And also, you have maybe a human error or misoperation. You may not even know what that likelihood of occurring is. And then you have sabotage. And so you may or may not know what likelihood to sabotage. I was working with a dam owner that had the homeless population building and digging holes and building their encampments right on the dry parts of their dam. So they knew that the likelihood of that sabotage occurring at that dam, it was high. But that might not be the case at your dam, or there could be other ways that sabotage can put into the picture. So let's look at two dams, and let's look at the threats with two dams. You have Dam A and you have Dam B. So Dam A doesn't have enough spillway capacity, but it's built on very, very solid bedrock. It's in the northwest part of the state. So up by the coast, you have Dam B, and it's a large amount of spillway capacity, but it's built on very, very poor foundation and soft, unstable soils. All right. So if you look at Dam A, flood is probably the major threat for Dam A because it cannot safely pass certain loads, certain flood loads that may occur. Woo! Here comes the flood. All right, Dam B, the earthquake might be a major threat, even though earthquake may not have a high probability of occurring. That's probably the biggest threat because it does have a lot of spillway capacity. So earthquake might be the biggest threat because it's really built on those poor, unstable soils. So next, let's talk a little bit about the performance of the dam and how this fits in. And John talked a lot about that. And we talked about to understand the performance, you really have to get a really good understanding of the current condition of the dam. Those are things like John talked about. Those are things, how is the dam maintained? Has it been inspected? Do you have a frequency affected? Do you have some of those problems that he pointed out, or do those exist at your dam? So that falls into the performance issue. Also, dam design falls into the performance issue. Like John said, some dams were designed before you had certain regulations in place. Other dams were designed at a point where the regulations might have been in place, but more people moved in to increase that risk around the dam. And so now the dam, it has higher risk and needs a new design standard. Or it might just be that the dam design is just not state of the practice anymore. And that goes the same to the dam construction as well. How was the dam constructed? Was it built years ago? Sometimes they use construction practices that are out of date, and it's found now that those construction practices often adversely affect the dam rather than help in certain instances. And also that goes into material that's used into the dam. So the dam is only as strong as its weakest point. And so if you use a material in construction that may degrade after 20 to 25 years, then your dam life is 25 years. So construction material can affect the performance. And also, like I said before in a previous example, dam location might affect the performance. Whether it's prone to hurricane and hurricane loadings or just maybe poor soils that we showed in our last example. And again, just to point out the fact that you may have Dam A and Dam B, and they're both high hazard potential classified dams, but Dam A may have been maintained well. The grass is cut often. The rodents are kept off. No issues at the dam. But Dam B, same type of dam could have been, hey, you know, the maintenance are off, you have rodents, you have seepage, you have boils that are presenting themselves, but the risk is different, and the risk does not necessarily correlate with the hazard potential classification. And that's the same thing. You can look at the consequence too. You might have two high hazard potential dams. One you know, might have a loss of life as one, and one might have a loss of life as a million. So the one that has a million loss of life and the one that has one loss of life are both high hazard potential dams, but the risk is different. And that's the point I wanted to really get across. You may have high hazard potential dams, very different than the risk that the dam actually poses to that community. And so now let's talk a little bit about incidents. So in FEMA, we call this, we have notice events and non-notice events. So notice events are just that. You have a little bit of notice before the event occurs. So you know that something might be going on. There's some warning time to do certain things, whether they're to do what we call interim risk reduction measures, or and that's to reduce the risk, things that you could do to reduce the risk, or things that you could do to kind of warn the general population. And John talked about a lot of the causes of the incidents that he talked about, just to go over a little bit. Oh, he talked about overtopping. He talked about the internal erosion of soils. And then he talked about inadequate maintenance and upkeep as well. So, Alicia, if you could switch to the video.
Can everybody see my screen okay?
Yeah, we can see it pretty good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So here you have a progression of an earthing dam failure. And you'll see some time stamps. This is the full breach progression of the failure, and that's the most likely you're going to get some time. Next video, please, Alicia. But you can also have sudden failure. This is a dam that's in Brazil that failed suddenly. And as you can see in this clip, you have people actively trying to get away from the flows of the failure. All right, we can move on to the next video, Alicia. So here, what I really Neil deGrasse Tyson should.
Sorry,
not,
it's an ad. I have.
Okay. It should not be on
it's
here.
Close.
It's taking a while. We may skip this. If it doesn't come on in the next few seconds, we'll skip it. So let's skip and let's go back to the slideshow, Alicia. And I'll just talk about it. All right. So what I was going to show you a simulation of a dam. Of a dam failure. So what that simulation is actually showing is a sudden breach to the dam. It's showing some people's residents, homes, streets, Preston. Daddy's talking. Excuse me. Streets and things that will be impacted by the dam if the dam was to fail. So on the next few pictures, and what I really want you to look at, I really want you to look at the things that are impacted by a potential dam failure. All right, those are things that could be impacted are things like roads, bridges, cars, people standing outside, buildings, and if you think about it, is the releases that you might experience from a dam failure might be different from regular flooding that those residents might be getting. So it has some characteristics that help us to understand those consequences, is how deep that the water is and how fast that water is moving. And so how deep that water is and how fast that water is moving is going to cause, it's going to cause more damage to infrastructure, more damage to people sitting outside, more damage to loss of life. So in certain areas, there's going to be, it's not just what's getting wet, it's how bad and how are those things getting impacted? Because there's a difference between maybe 1 foot of water moving very slowly, then a very deep water moving very quickly. That's going to do a lot of damages to and cause a lot of consequences from that dam. And here's just a picture of that depth of how deep water can get, and also how water can start carrying cars at a certain depth and velocity. Here, and it's very important to understand what and how are your roads going to be able to pass certain flows, because sometimes roads aren't designed to pass maybe a 50-year flood, but maybe not the flood that it might experience through maybe a dam break scenario. So then that may be a crucial in or out of your community. So really, really think about how if that dam was to break, what might be the consequences? Maybe nobody can get in here, or nobody can get out for days because that road might be destroyed by your dam breaking. And here's just a picture just showing what it looked like, what an area looked like dry and what it looked like wet after flooding events. So the consequences of a dam failure, and I really like this quote, it was by President Eisenhower, and it says, plans are worthless, but planning is everything. But to really, and we at FEMA, we really like plans. We require people to do all kind of plans, more than I even know. And we know South Carolina DHEC is a requirement to do emergency action plans, and we get that. We like the plans, but the planning part is really what mitigates or helps to eliminate or reduce risk. It's the planning process helps to reduce the risk. Just having a plan and putting that check mark by the plan without knowing what's in it, without doing any process before it really doesn't help to eliminate the consequence. But actually doing planning, working with different individuals, understanding your risk, that's what planning to reduce your risk is that's what actually reduces the risk to the public. And I really like this slide, and I'm going to say this a couple times too, that dam safety is really a shared responsibility. And I'm going to say it real law and real strong now, that dam safety is a shared responsibility, because it's really shared not just the dam owners and operators' responsibility. They have a real huge responsibility in dam safety, but it's not just that. There's other people with the roles and responsibility in dam risk management. So I talked about there's other people that can help reduce the risk, and the risk could be in three components. So there's people like the National Weather Service that are on the front end and help us to understand that threat part. The dam owners, the state dam safety program, the regulators, they really help that performance part. Emergency managers, state county officials, rulemakers, they really help with getting people out of the way and getting people informed and lessening those consequences at the disaster. And even the public has a role and responsibility in dam risk management to know their evacuation zones and things of that nature. And we'll talk some more about that in some of our later sessions. But there are a lot of vital players. This is not a one man show. It's not all on your shoulders, but working together. All right, working together and understanding other responsibilities of others is what really helps in reducing the risk, both threats all threats, performance, and consequences. So knowing your risk, some things that we talked about, compare and prioritize risk to determine, what threats merit special attention. We went through a little exercise that you can kind of really go on your own to really understand what threats do I have and why this might be a threat to my particular dam. What actions might be planned for? You can plan for many actions. Those are actions that you could do in emergency and also actions that you could do before the emergency goes, and then what resources are likely to be needed. Sometimes these resources, and we always think of material for the dam, and those are resources, really good resources to plan for too. But sometimes these resources are people. How am I going to get an engineer on staff? These are resources that you might need, and you really need to plan those things out before an incident happens. Help to understand potential consequences. Really understand those consequences if your dam failed, then it might have. What are some economic losses? What are the loss of benefits of the dam? And if your dam is a high hazard dam, what are those population at risk or for the loss of life? And there might be other impacts like environmental impacts that may occur and some consequences that you may have to deal with. An additional knowing your risk for HOAs is vandalism. John talked about it a little bit, no sense of urge of ownership, unrestricted, and the brain drain part. And I think this is really important, so I'll talk about this a little bit. So when you have homeowner associations where you may have someone who really knew the issues with the dam, who really have been coordinating with your regulators, who are just the point person for that dam, if they move or if they get voted out or if they even pass away, how are others understanding the issues about those dams, and also disgruntled HOA members and unauthorized operations and unrestricted access to your dam may be some unique issues. These risks that your dam has and planning for those things are very important. And John, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Hey, yeah, thank you, Preston. I just wanted to jump in real quick to talk about an effort and an initiative that we're doing in South Carolina. And actually, I want to acknowledge that a FEMA grant that we've received is helping to fund this initiative. But we are in South Carolina. This concept of risk, is something that we are, moving into that way of thinking. And so we want to we currently can't tell, we currently don't have a way of knowing which, you know, maybe of our high hazard dams, which ones have a higher risk, you know. And so we're undertaking an effort to, we're starting with 300 high hazard dams to do a screening level risk analysis and really come up with a ranking of which of our high hazard dams are actually the highest risk dams. And so we're using our engineering firm that that many of you may have actually encountered either doing inspections or you know in your interaction with DHEC. The CDM Smith is the engineering firm that's under contract to DHEC, and they are actually doing this analysis for us. And so by looking at four of these potential failure modes, hydrologic failure, which generally when we talk about hydrologic, we're talking about water and floods and how a dam, you know, a dam failing from a flood, a flood event causing overtopping as one potential failure mode. Another one being the internal erosion, that piping type of behavior that could lead to dam failure. Then slope failure, you know, where we talked about, you know, slumps and slides and slips, where you have a slope failure that could cause failure. And then lastly, earthquake. And what an earthquake, you know, how that can cause a dam to lose its strength and to crack or settle. And so looking at the four potential failure modes, so CDM Smith is using a team of engineers and assigning scores for these, you know, for these potential failure modes, and then also for what, you know, for what the performance of the dam, as we, you know, we talked about the performance of the dam, what the expected performance in each of these four potential failure modes, how the dam is expected to perform, and then lastly, what the consequences of failure would be for that dam. Say, for instance, you know, looking at how many homes would be flooded, and using that as another factor in this overall score. And so the results will be an overall risk score for these 300 high hazard dams, and that's just the start. You know, eventually we'll have all of our high hazard dams, but when these results are available, we will, you know, again make them available to our dam owners. But this is kind of a new way of thinking here in South Carolina, and so we're kind of excited to get those results finalized. And then once we do have those, we'll be sharing those with our community of dam owners. So that's all I had on that. Preston, you can take it back now.
All right. Thanks, John. And this will introduce you to Nick Slepsoff, and what he's going to talk about too is preparedness. Some things to preparedness is dam emergency action plans, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. Training, understanding your inundation mapping, identifying critical infrastructure and impacted business, and then communication with dam operator, local emergency management. And also in preparedness, this is this preparation for when you get that really intense rainfall, things that you could really think about when that threat comes. Evaluate the water level in the lake and pond. Determine if the water levels can be safely lowered from incoming flows. Coordinate releases with water of water with other dam owners and property owners downstream. And this is important. While it is safe, clear debris from spillways. And review your emergency action plan, and then keep alert and watch as the storm passes and watch for rising waters. So I believe, Nick, I'll hand it over to you.
Daddy, help!
Nick, are you on the line?
I guess we don't have Nick, so I see Nick is typing in the chat box right now. Let's see what he's. Oh, he's having to. All right, we'll have Nick back on shortly.
All right, so while we're waiting on Nick, I just wanted to say if you do have any questions, please put them in the chat box. If we don't get to them today, we will definitely get back to answers to the your questions for everybody. So please don't hesitate to ask your questions while we're going along. And this is an introduction to your emergency action plan. There is going to be a separate. And I know we're getting close to 7:30 in time, but there is going to be another section on that goes more into depth on your emergency action plan.
While we're still waiting on Nick, this is John McCain. I'm seeing a couple questions where people are interested in this this risk analysis. We should have the results soon. Actually, I was hoping to have at least a sampling of the data for today, but we didn't quite get that. But it should be completed soon, and the 300 high hazard dams were, you know, just the initial pool, and we'll expand that to all of our high hazard dams ultimately. But you know, I say soon. We're waiting on CDM Smith to finish that effort up, but my understanding is they're very close. And we're also under kind of a timeline due to it being a FEMA grant funded activity. My vague answer is soon.
John, did you see the first question about the lawyers, the attorneys?
Let me look. I missed that one. Let me go back and find it. A list of qualified legal representatives. We'll have to get back. We'll probably talk to our. Some of the attorneys that work for us, and then maybe, you know, some other sources. That's not a question I can answer today, but we will. That's one that we'll promise to get y'all some resources on legal advice. And I do have a list of engineers, though. I saw that someone asked about a list of dam engineers. We do maintain a list of engineers that have submitted permit applications. We
hear
don't
me now?
Have a list. There's Nick.
I
yes, sir, we can.
I apologize. I don't know what happened because I dialed this number and put the same pin in last three times. And I thought it's a technical glitch, I guess. So we'll get started on talking. John, did you want to finish up before I...
No, I'm done. I'm done.
Okay. So I'm going to be talking about a little bit about the emergency action plans and it's going to be something we're going to be talking about in a little bit more detail in the next delivery. So the emergency action plans or EAPs are something that are really important when you're looking at dams and especially those that are high hazards. So ask yourselves, do you think you have one? Do you know if one was put together maybe years ago, or maybe somebody put together and they moved away? But the point is this is a living, breathing document that goes with dams. And some of you may be familiar with this particular slide, and especially the EAP that's shown up there, because John has worked very hard, him and his staff, in getting EAPs put together across the state. He's probably one of the leaders in doing that in the country. So, you might be able to recognize what that is. But basically, the EAP is that planning process that Preston spoke about on paper, and getting the things that you need to do maybe beforehand, getting information out and those kinds of things. So our homework for you folks for next time the next session is find your EAP, and we'll go through a template that we have from the next webinar. And if you don't have it, you'll see there's an email address there for John's office, and they'll be able to get you one. So the first thing we need to make sure is that you folks have a dam point of contact. And this doesn't necessarily mean that person's doing all the work, but need one person that would have the ability to speak for what's in the EAP and getting things done that are related to your dams. You know, coordinating and scheduling maintenance and maintenance activities, knowing your EAP inside and out is very, very important. Providing a report on the condition of the dam to the full homeowners association at least annually. That way it gets them engaged in what you're doing if you're working at that point of contact. And then also work as try to get on, be on a first name basis with the DHAC's regional engineer. I believe John said there were six of them that worked throughout the state. If you have a high hazard dam, these folks are a wealth of resources and information and help to you as you go through the process of putting in EAP. You saw earlier the picture of the inundation map. Why is that important to not just you folks, but to as a former emergency manager, that would show me what the risk that Preston was speaking to, what risk there is to the community downstream. And then as an emergency manager, what you have to do is to look at that and be able to plan out for the worst case scenario. What would happen if everything went loose, and what would be affected in the community below? You know, are there, businesses? What's infrastructure like? Are there hospitals, nursing homes? What other residents might be downstream? So that inundation map that we spoke to is a very, very important piece to the planning process outside of your world in the dams, but also to the world of emergency planners within the community. So we spoke knowing about the potential consequences of a major failure of your dam. What the impacts are, it's basically flooding, trapped persons, injury, death, road closures, property damage, and debris, and other potential consequences. It doesn't necessarily mean it would be an immediate impact, but maybe long-term or like an environmental loss, economic loss, crop loss, the food chain distribution, if there's a major transportation route that might have been taken out, loss of wildlife and habitat, hazardous materials, is there a chemical plant or an industrial zone that might be affected? Looking at the loss of revenue, obviously, if you have a business that's flooded out and has to repair and take some 6-8 weeks or longer to get back in, that you're talking about some potential issues there. Disruption to the water supply. If the dam was a potential water source for the HOA, or if it was feeding to other areas, it might be a problem. Obviously, sewer overflow, water contamination goes along with that, and exposure of bacteria and disease, and also looking at what potentially it did to displace people. And what about if you're your dams lasted 60 years without any problems. Is that something to be concerned about, or the dam survived the floods of 215? Or, you know, what if you just inspected it, they had just inspected, why should they need to now? Past performance is no guarantee. You know, whether you made just repairs just now, this is why John was really emphasizing it. You know, walk your dam, get to know it. You know, look at the potential issues that he spoke to. You know, the rodents, the vegetation growth, and those kinds of things. Those are things that if you do it, you know, a lot more than just an annual inspection, you might be able to ward off any problems on down the road. And so here's another concern, is that there are people downstream of the dam and are in the floodplain, and don't they have to buy insurance? First of all, being downstream from a dam doesn't necessarily mean people are in a floodplain. The dam itself may be the only flood risk they have. And don't they have to buy flood insurance? No, they don't have to buy flood insurance. It's voluntarily, but it's you know, a common misconception that people in floodplains, in that 100-year floodplain, that they have to, that they're required to do that, but no. So that's some of the things that we're looking proactively to, perhaps, if you can't mitigate a problem, that might be something that you can message to the people who are downstream. So we're talking about the emergency action planning process, and this, again, what Preston spoke to, the plan itself is that document that the end result of the process. And emergency planning and looking at the emergency threat to the dam that happens, you know, what is it, rain, or if there's a malfunction of the dam or whatever, you know, how you're going to integrate your county emergency management, your 911 center, how's DHAC going to be contacted? What you're going to be concerned with in that EAP is really partnering with those people who have boots on the ground. And that's the people within your community, the fire service, law enforcement, EMS, of course, emergency management, and it really, really helps to get those people introduced to your plan, and that you get to really have a relationship with them, so you're on a first name basis. So, in event something does happen, what you know, everybody with the right hand knows what the left one's doing. And that's extremely important. Again, that's like Preston spoke to in the planning process, that where you sit down with these people and actually go through a plan. A lot of emergency managers will use the emergency action plan as an annex to their emergency operations plan, which addresses all the emergencies for their communities. So, you know, you might want to keep that in mind if you're working with your emergency manager, and they may want some of their information from your plan to do just that. Looking at post-recovery events, you know, what after the dam failed, you know, what are you going to do for recovery and restore roads or buildings or those kinds of things? And at the end of the process, you're going to be doing an update. You do updates not if you have an emergency only, but you do updates on a regular basis. Sometimes one once a year would be something worthwhile, or maybe you know, something that the local public safety officials would want to do maybe a couple times a year. It's something you'd have to talk to them about. But then again, that's extremely important. It's not just having that plan updated after you have an event, but yeah, it's an ongoing. It's a living, breathing document.
Nick. Just as a quick time check, we have less than 5 minutes.
Okay. So basically, we're going to get into all of this before the next time we do a presentation. So I'm gonna fly through some of these slides here very quickly to do that, go through the emergency. We'll go through this for the next presentation. The biggest thing is emergency action, the process, and getting people, getting you as dam owners familiar with the people who have boots on the ground if an emergency happens. I think at the end of the day, that's probably the most important message that we want to bring. And we'll speak to the emergency management functions at the next presentation. And, John, back to you.
Okay. Hey, thank you. Thank you, Nick. Yeah, I'm sorry we had to rush there. I think I took too much time early on. But, yeah, EAPs, and that's the whole point of the second webinar. So we'll cover that in depth. I wanted to talk just to briefly – DHEC is here to provide a lot of help and services in this regard of emergency planning and like Preston talked about earlier, dam safety is a shared responsibility. You're not alone. So DHEC, we can help. Technical assistance. Our regional engineers and our central office engineers. We want to help answer your questions and give you the hopefully training and education that you need or point you in the right direction. We can assist you with creating your emergency action plan. In 2017 we came out with a new template, a much more extensive document, and we can help you create that. We can do that inundation mapping I talked about earlier. We can help you. We can provide that for you. We can put you in touch with your county emergency management. We can help with that relationship and make those connections. As part of that inundation mapping, we can also help you in identifying the downstream properties that could be affected by a failure of your dam. And then we can also help work with both you and your county emergency management. If you need a customized emergency notification plan, if you have so many properties and homes maybe downstream that calling them is just not effective, maybe you need a customized notification plan, and maybe the county can help you with those notifications. And so we can help with that. So just want to make sure everyone is aware that we're your partners in this, and we provide a lot of services that I hope you'll take advantage of. All right, man. Preston.
Yeah, and hopefully we could get you a copy of this page. So I know it's after 7:30, and we really respectful of your time. But here, as John said, here are some really good resources. Start off with the South Carolina DHEC resources. They have some really good webinars. And also they have a really good emergency situation call-in number, so really note that. Then the FEMA National Dam Safety Program, we have some really good resources for you there as well. And then really look at, there's another organization called the Association for State Dam Safety Official. They have some great resources, some things. Simple things like getting the engineer. They have some resources there on their site that really can help you. So really take advantage of those, and hopefully we can share this with you afterwards. We also have some grant programs. The Dam Safety Program has the last one, the High Hazard Potential Rehab Grant Program. There are some eligibility criteria, and we do work through the states, and they're all. So get familiar with your state. Your state hazard mitigation officers, also South Carolina DHEC, and they can help you through this process and to see if you're actually eligible for getting one of those FEMA grants. So now we're going to say, are there any other questions that we didn't get to already? If there are, you could please put them in the chat. And I think we covered all the ones that we had so far. Alicia?
Yes, we did.
This is John. You know, like the that email address is not correct on this slide. It looks like we forgot to update that email address. But if you want to submit any submit questions to the email address, the response@dhec.sc.gov. I think we're going to type it. It's already in the chat box. But feel free to submit questions to that response@dhec.sc.gov, and we will we'll either respond to you individually, or if we think the entire group would benefit, we'll provide answers to the group. So, and again, I apologize. We've run. I think I ran long, and I apologize for that.
And just to speak to the questions and the PowerPoint questions, so we just have to make this document compliant, and we'll fix some of these typos, but we plan on having that out to you guys within the next day or so, as well as a written record of the questions and answers that we received today and the information needed to get your accreditation or CEUs for this webinar.
All right. Let's see. So next steps, I will, from here, again, if you have questions or we will take care of those, after tonight. But as far as I would just like to, say thank you for everyone that participated and joined in. Our next session is, again, on understanding my emergency action plan and also inundation mapping. And some of the outcomes we hope to achieve will be to better understand the components of your emergency action plan. And I hope you'll find yours and have it so that we can go through those components together. We'll understand how to read inundation maps. And use those maps to support your planning efforts. I'll talk about DSSWise Lite, which is that's the actual software DHEC uses. Talk about EAPs and how that relates to how counties, the county emergency management plans, and then understand the roles and responsibilities of dam owners and local emergency managers. Again, if anyone needs a CEU for this webinar, Alicia can help you with that. And then you have to provide a course evaluation to get that those CEUs.
And this will all be in an email out to everybody, so nobody needs to mess the slide.
Perfect. So I think with that, for as far as DHEC, I just want to thank you all. Thank everyone for participating. I hope, it was informative. Let me know if DHEC know if your expectations were not met, or definitely let us know how we can, make this even more helpful and useful for you folks. So definitely we would love to hear feedback. And thank you again for participating. All right, Preston?
Yeah. Thanks for participating today. Tell your friends, other dam owners about the next one, property managers or anyone you work with about they're all welcome. So thanks for participating.
Nick, you got anything you want to say?
No, I think we'll have a lot more information for the EAP and EAP development and networking with the public safety officials. I think that would be a key. So I appreciate everybody staying online for our overrun, and we'll talk to you next month.
All right. Katie Goolsby-Brown, I don't know if you we didn't introduce you, but I think you're on the call. Actually, you're not a – I don't think Katie can speak. She's not a presenter. And then Molly, I guess Molly, y'all will hear from Molly more in one of the future webinars. So, and I think with that, I just want to say thank you to everyone and hope you have a good evening. Thank you for your patience and good night.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, John.